Good evening, and welcome to Nash Forward, the 2015 premier mayoral debate series presented by Belmont University, the Tennessean, and broadcast partner WSMV-TV. I'm Harry Chapman, Director of Special Projects and Major Gifts at Belmont University, and it's my pleasure to welcome you to McAfee Concert Hall, the site for this mayoral debate. I will be introducing the candidates to you, and I would ask that after I do the introductions, please hold your applause until all candidates have been introduced. The introductions will be done in random order, and I'll start off to my right with Mr. David Fox. Mr. Fox is a former Metro Nashville School Board Chairman who most recently worked at Titan Advisors, a hedge fund based in New York. Next is Charles Robert Bone, a local business owner and lawyer who runs a law practice that represents business and government entities throughout the state of Tennessee. Next is Megan Berry, a two-term at-large councilwoman who has worked as a corporate executive and most recently the ethics and compliance officer for Premier Incorporated, a healthcare company. Next, Linda Eskin Rebovic. She has served as executive positions at IBM, Dell, and several other private corporations before taking her current position as CEO of Consensus Point, a consumer marketing research firm. Next, Jeremy Kane was CEO of LEAD, an organization that runs seven Nashville charter schools, and previous speechwriter for former Massachusetts Senator and now Secretary of State John Kerry. Howard Gentry is next. He is the 20th Judicial District's Criminal Court Clerk for Davidson County and former Nashville Vice Mayor. He is also a two-term councilman at large. And next, Bill Freeman. Bill is CEO, founder of Freeman Welb, a property management and real estate investment company, and the former director of Downtown Urban Development for MDHA. These are our candidates, ladies and gentlemen. At this time, I would like to introduce you our moderator for this evening's event, Mr. David Plias with the Nashville Tennessean. Thank you, David.
Good evening. Thank you very much, Mr. Chapman. Welcome, candidates, and thank you to our audience both here at McAfee Concert Hall on Belmont University's campus and also at home on television on Channel 4 and Tennessean.com and your Tennessean app. We want to thank you so much for joining us. This is the second NashForward debate we've had. In the first one, we focused on leadership and crisis management. This time, we're focused on millennials. Millennials make up about 4 out of 10 residents in Nashville, and their growth is tremendous, ranking as high as number 2 on some indicators. And that's why, while I'll be moderating, there'll be 14 millennial students and young professionals who'll be asking the questions tonight. We'll have 3 rounds of questions. In the first round, each candidate will have 60 seconds to answer a question from one of the millennials. They'll be divided into trios. After each question, they'll have a chance to have up to 2 rebuttals per round. Round 2 is the lightning round. These are quick hit questions. And round 3 is just like round 1. The thing that we want to do is tell you that we're going to be fair to all candidates. All of you will begin first at one point. You'll all end at another point, so everybody will have equal time from that standpoint. One of the things we'd like you to do at home or here in the audience is if you'd like to tweet or post, please use the hashtag NashForward. The students and professionals here are also using that. They may also tweet. They may engage in the conversation with you during this debate. Also, one thing to announce is that at 7:45 p.m., a poll on Tennessean.com will launch, and we'll be asking you, who do you think won this debate? That poll will be open through noon on Friday, and at that moment, the Tennessean will reveal who won according to the reader's poll. Again, this is an unscientific poll. Again, we thank the candidates, and let's get together to round 1. The first question will be asked by Kirk Beto.
At Belmont University. I'm studying political science and journalism at Belmont University, and I'm also the editor-in-chief of the Belmont Vision. And my question is, how does your leadership style set you apart from the other candidates, and what makes you the best choice for Nashville?
So this question is for Mr. Fox, Mr. Bone, and Ms. Berry.
Kirk, thank you very much for your question. And leadership style is very important. And I had an opportunity to serve on the school board, had a chance to pull together a group of nine very disparate people, very different ideas. And as we know, as we watch the school board, it's not always a happy group. It can be a little contentious. And what I focused on is trying to bring us together as a group to make, you know, consensus decisions. And as mayor, I want to kind of use all the capacity, the intellect, all the brain power of our community to come together and come to consensus on these critical issues that face our city. That's how I approach issues. I'm not really a command and control. I don't want to shove ideas down anyone's throats. I want to take advantage of the great brain power we have in our community. Thanks, Kurt.
Thank you, Mr. Bucks. Mr. Boone.
I think what I have is an understanding. When I think about the next mayor that we need in Nashville, I think we need a mayor that understands where we are, where we've been, but also where we're headed. Having grown up here my entire life, I'm thrilled with the momentum and amazed with the momentum of the city. But like you, I'm concerned about how we maintain our authenticity and how we achieve not just growth, but how we achieve thoughtful growth. I want a mayor who's knowledgeable and experienced. Having served as general counsel of the Music City Center, I understand that the business of metro government is a hard, complicated $1.9 billion business. But also want a mayor who has a vision for the entire city. Having grown up near Gulletsville, having gone to school in Madison, having met my wife there who's from Donelson, having lived downtown and in Tusculum and Green Hills and in West Nashville, I know that we need a vision for the city of Nashville that says every child matters. But also, I think it's important that the next mayor understand that being mayor of Nashville is a great job, but it comes with the tremendous responsibility of ensuring that we sustain our momentum.
Thank you, Mr. Boone. Appreciate it. Ms. Berry.
Question. And I think when I think about leadership and I think about what the next mayor needs to be, I think the next mayor needs to understand government and understand business and then also bring their passion and their energy and their vision to make Nashville an amazing place. So many of our millennials who live here choose to stay here. We need to find the way to keep them here. And for me, that means having a vision for transit, affordable housing, and education. Those are the three areas that we hear the most about. And for me, making sure that our millennials understand and know that affordable housing is key. If you want to stay here, we have to make it affordable for you. But you also have to get around. And ultimately, if you can't get around, you're not going to be able to get to that fabulous job. So for me, the next mayor has to have all of those components as part of her vision. And as the next mayor, that's what I look forward to doing. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Would any candidate like to rebut in this round? Okay. We'll move on to the next question, and Suad Abdullah will ask this question.
I'm Suad Abdullah, a teacher at Metro Nashville Public Schools, and I'm originally from Kurdistan. I'm here to represent Islamic Center of Nashville. As a public school teacher, I noticed that our education system needs continuously to improve around academic excellence and social-emotional well-being of students. What's your vision and how will you implement that vision for public education that is reflective of our demographics and that's globally competitive?
This question is for Ms. Eskin-Rebrovic, Mr. Kane, and Mr. Freeman.
Yes, thank you for that question. You know, a smarter Nashville means we must invest in education. It starts with making sure that we empower the principals and the teachers, because they need to take control of the classroom. That's where the student is, that's where the decisions are made, and that's where they can make sure that we do protect that social well-being. It's about making sure we have after-school programs so that all of our children have an opportunity to be successful in school, to keep up, to track with the programs that they're involved in, and that we make sure we leave no one behind. It is, of course, about making sure we have technology. I want to make sure that our students are prepared to go out into the world, that they've learned on the tools that they're going to be using. And lastly, I want to make sure that every child, every one of your children, get an excellent education in our school system. And so we must make sure that they all perform at the highest standard and that we continue to protect those
children.
Thank
you very much, Mrs. Kimberbeck. Mr. Kane.
I think ultimately education comes down to starting with a strong start, a secure future, and a second chance if you need it. So with a strong start, we have a 3.5-year-old daughter at home. We're lucky enough to be able to send her to childcare. A child's brain grows more in the first 3 years of their life than the rest of our lives altogether. We owe it to our children to give them that strong start. I've talked about linking incentives with increasing child care facilities, both in our public schools and in our private sector. When I talk about a secure future, we're talking about schools of your choice. That's linked directly to transit. That's linked to working with hardworking teachers like yourself. At Cameron, we hired the first Kurdish-speaking teacher and Metro Schools as an office manager. It increased parental engagement. It increased community engagement. That was part of your question. That's an incredibly important part of it. And it's part of providing a second chance. I'm the one that started this conversation about opening up our school spaces as community zones where we have after-school programs, nonprofit programs, and community engagement involved all throughout the day.
Thank you, Mr. Kane. Mr. Freeman.
I've talked about public education for the last 12 months. And one of the things that I want to do is change the narrative about our public education system. We've got a lot to be proud of in Davidson County in our public school system. Our teachers are doing a tremendous job. Our schools are doing a tremendous job. I visited now 26 different schools around the county, and they're doing a tremendous job in these schools, and they're tired of this narrative of our failing Davidson County school system. We've got a steep hill to climb. We speak 151 different languages in our public school system. Some of the surrounding counties speak two languages. We're doing a great job with a very difficult set of circumstances. I've talked about increasing the funding for our public school system. For every one percentage point we raise the budget for public education, it adds another $19 million to our school system. So I'm going to change the narrative about our public school system. We're going to improve it. But we're going to talk about it honestly and point out the good things.
Thank you very much, Mr. Freeman.
Thank you.
Are there any rebuttals? Mr. Fox.
Suad, we've been dealt a beautiful hand of children, the most intellectually gifted children I can imagine. We haven't always been dealt a good hand of adults. And by adults, I mean the civic leaders who are supposed to be responsible for the education of our children. What I saw when I was chairman of the school board, working with Mayor Dean, if you have an engaged mayor, who'll be a cheerleader when things are happening well, but a critical friend when you need improvement, that's the only way to get important results. And as mayor, I will bring that to the table to make sure there's urgency, the same urgency I
provide my
own kids. Thank you.
Any other rebuttals? Mr. Bone.
I think when you consider that less than half of our children are scoring at state level, third through eighth grade, in reading and math, and when you consider that 60% of our children are going to a school in the bottom quartile in the state, and that less than 1,800 kids that graduate this year will go on to college or to a post-secondary institution, we have far more and far deeper and far more complex work in front of us than just changing the narrative. This has to be real work. It starts in the classroom, on the literacy levels, and it starts with college attainment.
Thank you, Mr. Bone. Any other rebuttals? Ms. Berry. Oh, I'm sorry, Mr. Gentry, and then Mr. Gentry, please, go ahead. Ms. Berry, then.
I think it is important to talk about what we do well, but I also think we need to have an honest conversation about where our challenges are. We do want to make sure our kids are kindergarten ready. So one of the things you talked about was social emotional readiness. And I think if our kids come in ready to learn in kindergarten, we can make that happen by a universal pre-K program. I've talked about that from the beginning. I will make sure that we find the funding. We won't leave anyone on those wait lists, and those kids will be ready to learn so that by third grade they're reading and they can go on and graduate and be college and career
ready.
Thank
you, Ms. Berry.
Thank you.
Mr. Gentry.
You know, money is not going to fix our schools, and it's not going to make our students learn more. It's going to have to be allowing the schools to function. The principals need to be able to run their schools. They need to be able to hire good teachers. I grew up in North Nashville. I was educated in North Nashville. We had a great school, great teachers, and it's no different today. It's the fact that a lot of our schools now are in our poorer areas and they're not functioning at the level that they could. We can do better.
Thank you, Mr.
And
Fincher.
We will. Thank you.
Any other rebuttals? The next question will be asked by Christoph Hart.
I'm Christoph Hart, a senior music business major at Belmont University, and I'm actively involved in my school, my industry, and my local community, and I believe in the collaboration of all in order to achieve the individual goals of many. My question is, within the last decade, our city has seen a tremendous amount of growth in the development of housing, residential communities, and new businesses. This growth has expanded to many parts, including some of the more low-income communities of our city. What is your plan of action to aid and accommodate those in these communities as they may not be able to financially weather said growth?
This question is for Mr. Gentry, Mr. Fox, and Ms. Eskind-Rebervik. Mr. Gentry.
Growth is great, and growth is a problem, and we have to balance it. And so what I'm going to do is I'm going to develop an office of social equity. That office is going to ensure that every time we have a development within the city, be it a housing development or a corporate development, that we are going to look at how that development affects the community around it. So when we go into lower income communities, we're going to ensure that the people who live in those communities can stay in those communities. We're going to look at how that development affects not just today, the market time or the market period, but how it affects the community 10, 20 years from now. We will have everybody around the table, developers, nonprofits, and housing persons involved, and we will be around that table and we will ensure that everybody is effective in a positive way and everybody will improve as a result of it.
Thank you. Mr. Fox.
Christoph, we've knocked on 40,000 doors in my campaign, having one-on-one conversations with people all over the city. And we hear, as much as anything, that one issue, the fear of gentrification, rebuilding of neighborhoods, and being priced out. I remember speaking with a councilman in Sevier Park about 10 or 15 years ago who said, you know, things are changing here. Young people are coming in, the prices are going up, and all the people who are renting are going to be forced out. And he was certainly right. So I think there are two or three things we need to do to really get in charge of the situation so that we don't become a homogenous city. One thing we can do is we can grandfather people's tax burdens or property tax burden. We can designate areas where we want to protect people so that, you know, it's not right for property tax increases to force people out of their homes. We can also partner with the private sector, rebuilding together as an organization that helps lower-income people make repairs so they can remain in their home. Thanks.
Thank you very much, Mr. Fox. Ms. Eskind-Rebervik.
Nashville can continue to grow, and we can give everyone a safe and affordable place to live. When I look at affordable housing, I see several opportunities. First, we can be very innovative. We can do things like co-housing, like is in Germantown right now, a development where you have a big social area, and you pay just for your rooms and your bathrooms. We can look at opportunities to scale. We can find select neighborhoods who want to let us do zoning that allows us to build density with micro units and micro villages. I have been saying since the beginning of my campaign that one thing as mayor I can do is take inventory of all of our underutilized and unused properties and give that to MDHA and to developers to create affordable housing. Well, guess what? Last week, Mayor Dean announced that he was going to do that, and I will continue to support that. There are many opportunities for us to make sure that we balance our growth with affordable housing. Thank you.
You very much, Ms. Eskind-Rebervik. Are there any rebuttals? Mr. Bone.
Given the importance of this issue, I'd like to add to it. I would perform a gentrification audit that not only identified where gentrification is occurring, but also to begin to use data to predict where it will occur. Two, I think the mayor needs to set the tone. And the tone needs to be that as we make public investments and encourage or lay the groundwork for private investments, that that will be first and foremost for the stability of the neighborhood and the people who are there first and foremost, not the instability of the neighborhood. And the type of development that we need to be encouraging are the services that our families need.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bowe. That was your last rebuttal for this round. Mr. Kane.
Part of my leadership style is there's a phrase called good poets borrow and great poets steal. 16 years ago, Nashville elected a mayor who made it a priority. In over 8 years, Mayor Purcell helped create 25,000 affordable housing units. He had a great plan. I want to follow that plan. It did three things. One, he made it a priority. Two, he tied TIF financing to the development and increasing affordable housing. And three, he said, as I will say to every single senior, you will not be priced out of your home because of property taxes. And if you're an artist, if you're a youth, a teacher, a police officer,
thank
you will
very
not
much,
lose
Mr.
your
King.
Home.
Any other rebuttals? Ms. Berry.
Growth is good, and we need to continue to grow. But you are absolutely right that we have this big challenge. We have to be intentional about where we're going to go from here, and it is about planning. I serve on the Homeless Commission, and recently we had an issue with James Robertson where we had a displacement of 100 people. Now, had we known that was going to happen, we could have planned for that.
So now we have a plan in place to look at all of those other properties where there are growing populations and the excitement around those areas is changing so that we can protect that housing. And that's what the next mayor has to do.
Any other rebuttals? Ms. Berry, that was your last rebuttal of this round as well. We'll go on to question four, Benjamin Eagles.
Hi, my name is Benjamin Eagles. I'm a graduate of Vanderbilt, and I've lived in Nashville since 2007. I'm here representing NOAA, Nashville Organized for Action and Hope. My question is, do you support prioritizing hiring Davidson County residents on city taxpayer-funded construction projects? If so, what will you do as mayor to make sure that happens? Thank you.
This question is for Mr. Bone, Mr. Freeman, and Mr. Kane. Mr. Bone.
I do support the charter amendment. I signed the petition and look forward to voting for it. But in addition to the charter amendment, one of the things Mayor Dean got right at the beginning of his administration was to say that on every public project, we're going to pursue a goal of 20% DBE minority spending. And while there are improvements that can be brought to bear on that program, I'd like to match that with local hiring. I think that's important on all public projects, particularly when we think about our economic development strategy in this city. The Community Action Report says that to break even in this city, we need to make $38,000 a year. Well, from an economic development standpoint, we do pretty good on the lower end of the scale and the higher end of the scale, but where we lack is in those jobs in the middle that this program can actually have a benefit. So I think it's important in this city to send the message that not only will we continue to encourage local DBE spending and refine that program, we will also make the hiring of local workers a priority.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bill. Mr. Freeman.
Thank you. And thank you very much for that question. I think all of us are for hiring Davidson County residents. I wish every person that we could hire would be a Davidson County resident. We've got low bid requirements and all kinds of other issues that come into play there, but I will do everything I can do to hire Davidson County residents first, to emphasize hiring Davidson County residents first, just like we do in our company when we do renovation work, construction work. So that's a priority for me. There's some rules that we have to work within, but I will work on that. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Freeman. Mr. Kane.
The answer is yes, but let me tell you what I would do as mayor is, first and foremost, we have to be transparent and we have to be accountable. Something that I've done in starting and running and operating a group of public charter schools has been very transparent. At the end of every year, we publish all of our results. That's part of my leadership style. That's something I bring into the mayor's office, very different from the other candidates running for mayor, is I'm comfortable with that transparency. We should all be comfortable with that and expect that of our next mayor. We need to look at the companies and who they're hiring and making sure that they are meeting those requirements. The second piece of it is, how do we work with our high schools and our local universities to make sure that we have workers who are trained and ready to be hired right here in Davidson County? Our academies program is phenomenal. But we look at it, our two greatest gaps between available workers and available jobs, database engineers and concrete engineers. MTSU has one of the country's leading concrete engineering programs. We should be able to find a way to partner our academies, especially Antioch and Cambridge, with MTSU so we make sure that workers are here and ready to be
hired.
Thank
you very much, Mr. Kane. Any rebuttals? We'll move on to the next question. Jonathan Joyce, please.
I'm Jonathan Joyce, Nashville native, senior political science major at Belmont University, and intern at Waller, Lansdowne, Dorch, and Davis. Do you believe that taxes will need to be raised during your administration to pay for the cost of government, and by how much?
This question is for Ms. Berry, Ms. Eskind-Rebrovic, and Mr. Fox. Ms. Berry.
Thank you for the easy one. Thank you for the question. I think that we always have to say, what do we want as a city and what kind of services do we want to provide? Education costs money, sidewalks cost money, fire and police. When we look, though, at how we allocate those resources, we also have to say, what do we do for the tax burden for our citizens? So in my administration, I look forward to finding other new revenue sources so that we can keep our tax base low. One of the things that makes Nashville such a great place to live and work is that we are a low-tax place. That helps us recruit and retain a lot of business. It also helps us attract millennials who want to stay here. I think the conversation that we will end up having is, how do we want to allocate the resources that we have? When we have limited resources, we have to make decisions about where we're going to invest. And as your next mayor, I will make those decisions. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ms. Eskind-Rebrovic.
Yes. As a business executive, I am always expected to be fiscally responsible and smart. And a smarter Nashville means that we are going to make sure that our government runs more efficient and effective so that you as taxpayers know that you are getting a return on your investment. I am going to make sure that we reduce costs, that we reduce waste, and that's how we're going to have more money to put into things that are more important. For instance, there are energy savings. By going into our buildings and using real-time sensor technology to reduce the cost of energy by 20%, by 30%, the same thing with our streetlights. This is about managing our operations effectively. I am going to make sure that you understand exactly how we're spending our money, you understand exactly why we spent the money that way, and you're going to know that your money is being protected and that we are going to be running this government in a way that's fiscally smart and responsible. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Mr. Fox.
Now, John, I think we're adequately funded. I think we've got good sources of revenue in the property tax and the sales tax, and I see no reason why we should expect to need to increase any of those rates. You know, oftentimes when we come to these forums, I sometimes walk away feeling like there's a feeling that we're sort of at an all-you-can-eat salad bar, and some rich uncle or Santa Claus is going to pay for it all. As a fiscal conservative, I really focus on how much money we spend, frankly, how much money we've borrowed, and understand there's a connection between that and ultimately the risk of higher taxes. So I take that very seriously. When I was on the school board late in my term, we made a tough decision. We were short, about $8 or $10 million short. We decided to privatize our janitorial and custodial. It was a tough decision, but it saved $7 million that year. So millions every year have gone back into the classroom. That's the type of perspective, sensibility that I'll bring to these issues. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Fox. Are there any rebuttals? Okay, we'll move on to the next question. This next question will be asked by Ariel Ellis.
Good evening. My name is Ariel Ellis. I am a public relations professor at Lipscomb University. I also serve as a consultant in diversity and inclusion. Tonight, I'm representing the National Coalition of 100 Black Women Metro Nashville Chapter. My question. Reports show that with the upcoming majority-minority shift among ethnic populations and age groups, millennials will be on the cusp of political and community engagement. As the next mayor, what is your plan for including younger voices who want to be a part of the local conversations and decisions within your administration, specifically people of color? And what will you do to create a legacy of inclusion for millennials who are becoming highly influential in business and community?
This question is for Mr. Kane, Mr. Gentry, and Mr. Boone. Mr. Kane.
I think this is a great question. I appreciate your asking it. And I look back at what we did at LEAD, and one of the things I'm proudest of is the results we got, but I'm even prouder of how we got those results and the people we hired and the communities we reached out to. And what we looked at, our first school was predominantly African American, and what we said was we needed folks of color who could be examples, who could be teachers and partners and mentors with our students. And if we just sat back, our teachers would not come to us. So we partnered with TSU, we partnered with local universities, we partnered with millennials to come in and be part of that conversation. But what we found with our millennial generation is you all are ready to get to work right away. I remember folks coming in and saying, I want to be CEO within 2 years. And what we did there was to say, absolutely, you can job shadow me, you can be a part of the decision making, come to board meetings. As mayor, it's about kicking open those doors of government. It's about using technology. It's about being transparent and accountable with data. It's about opening and being part of the community. We've held over 15 town halls as part of this campaign, oftentimes with millennials.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kane. Mr. Gentry?
If you look at my campaign, you'll see that I'm probably the oldest person in it. There's one more sitting out in the lobby, too, but I won't point her out. But the fact is that I understand how important it is, because you are the life, the blood of Nashville, and you are the heartthrob of Nashville, and you are the future of Nashville. So it's important that you have a voice and that you're involved now. And you're also smart, and you also are able to have the energy and the ability to think beyond yourself into the future. In my office right now, in the criminal court clerk, millennials are all over the place. We started with an older team, but in the last 4 years, millennials make up almost half of my management team. I will continue that as mayor, and it will be a policy of mine throughout my administration.
Thank you, Mr. Gentry. Mr. Bone.
Certainly, I think your question goes both to diversity and to how you involve millennials. From the diversity standpoint, we had a study late last year, early this year, that said 44 of 50 department heads were white, and that those in the top three pay scales in Metro Nashville, it was 84% white. We certainly don't need a study to tell us that we probably lack in our engagement of millennials, both in the mayor's office and in Metro government. My commitment is to have both an office and a Metro government that looks like the community we serve. And certainly when we begin to talk about education, transportation, infrastructure, and affordable housing, it impacts the millennial generation more so than any other generation. When you think about transportation, we have a generational opportunity to transform how we do transit in this city by thinking 5, 6, 7 years out and embracing that generational turn and embracing the opportunity to do technology. So you'd be well represented both in my office and my government.
Thank you very much. Are there any rebuttals? Ms. Eskin-Rebrovic.
You know, I've spent my life making sure that diversity was a program that was well-respected within big corporations and within the community of Nashville. You know, I have interviewed many millennials. I have children who are millennials, and I have found that millennials are very focused on social good, and that is what our government is all about. It gives them a chance to help make sure that social justice and that we do the right thing in our community. So I'm going to encourage millennials to have a voice and get involved in our government.
Thank you, Ms. Eskin-Rebrovic. Mr. Gentry.
I've stated that I'm running on experience, and I've stated also that I'm going to be the Chief Diversity Office of Metro Government. And experience is my Department of Criminal Court Clerk, where I have 56% women in my office. I have 33% minorities. I have 5 people of other cultures. And in my management team, half of my management team are females. That's what has happened over the last 4 years since I've been criminal court clerk, and that's going
Thank
to happen
you,
when
Gentry.
I'm mayor. Thank you.
And this was your final rebuttal. Any other rebuttals? We'll move on to the last question of this round, and it'll be asked by Danny Costurco.
Hi, I'm Danny Costurco, a recent Belmont graduate with a BA in English writing and a minor in marketing. And so as a recent college graduate, I'm looking for affordable housing within the city, but currently I can only afford outside of the city, which means longer commute times. So my question is, what are your plans to bring more affordable housing within the city?
This question goes to Mr. Freeman, Ms. Berry, and Mr. Gentry. Mr. Freeman.
Thank you for that question. I've outlined a plan to add 10,000 affordable housing units in the next 4 years, 2,500 units a year for 4 years. I've actually talked about adding 20,000 affordable housing units in the next 4 years for a total of 30,000 affordable housing units. My company is in the housing business. We were the National Property Management Company of the Year in 2010. We manage about 15,000 apartment units, over $1 billion worth of properties that we own and or manage for clients. So I know something about affordable housing. I know we have a great need for affordable housing. I know what incentives stimulate local developers to come in and add affordable housing. I know what works. I know what government programs work. And I'll get 10,000 affordable housing units built in the next 4 years. I outlined that plan probably a year ago and have been talking about it consistently as a need for our community in terms of affordable
Thank
housing.
Thank you, Mr. Freeman.
Thank you.
Ms. Berry.
So you want to stay here, and we need to make it easy for you. So we need to find a place for you to live. And in order for you to be able to get to your job, you need the transit option to get you there. Because right now, if we can save you on your transit costs, you can put that towards some of your housing costs. And that's one of our biggest challenges. Recently, I was looking at some housing prices and some rental property. My goodness, it's like $2,300 just to live like in a one bedroom. Nobody can afford that. So how do we make it happen for you? Well, we focus on making developers build affordable housing. And we do that by incenting them. And we also give them goals. And we're working on that legislation right now in Metro Council. Because this can't wait for the next mayor. The next mayor is going to have to lead on this. But we need to make this happen now. Because we're losing our affordable housing every day. So my hope for you is that we can find you that place to live and that you can live in the city and that you can stay in Nashville.
Thank you, Ms. Berry. Mr. Gentry.
Well, I want to invite you to a community where there is affordable housing. I live in Bordeaux, and we have affordable housing there. Antioch, there's affordable housing there. Unfortunately, and again, it's just a reality, a lot of people don't want to live in Bordeaux. A lot of people don't want to live in Antioch because of those areas, and they feel like something's wrong with those areas. The reality is there's nothing wrong with the areas. The fact is that as mayor, I'm going to look at those areas and stand up and talk about how great they are. I'm going to invite people to really be a part of the Bordeaux community and a part of the Antioch community, and we're going to make those communities safer. We're going to make those communities communities that you want to live in and want to be a part of. And if there needs to be more sidewalks, more lighting, then we're going to do that. Because Nashville really has the opportunity for you to live close to downtown. It's just that we have to want to live there, and we've got to make it a place you want to live.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gentry.
Thank you.
Are there any rebuttals from Mr. Fox?
Yes, Danny, a good friend of mine grew up in Los Angeles. And about 30 years ago, he said, they had a sudden problem, as you're noticing here in affordable housing, had a big problem in transit. And those were the first indications that the quality of life in Los Angeles was starting to decline. So we need to take this very seriously just for that reason, because we're at a critical point in our history, I think, in Nashville. There's a lot of pressure to require that developers set aside a certain amount of apartments or buildings for below market pricing. I'm not a stick guy, I'm a carrot person. I think we can give incentives to make it happen. Thank you.
Any other rebuttal? Ms. Eskin-Rebrovic.
Yes, I want to mention, in addition to the three innovative ways that we can improve affordable housing in Nashville, that our MDHA has been approved for a program called Rental Assistance Demonstration. This is going to give us the opportunity to scale our housing, look at our public housing opportunities, because the federal government is passing that ownership on to us. They are going to be able to double and triple the number of homes. It could be mixed. It will be mixed use, and it could be mixed income housing. So stay on the lookout for that, too.
Thank you very much. Mr. Kane?
I think going back to the previous question, the millennials, you all have a sense of mission, and we want you to be here, but we also want you involved in our civic life. As we already provide a rental subsidy for our artist community, I've proposed a rental subsidy if you teach in our public schools and live close by your school you work in. For our police officers and firefighters, is we need our employees to work and live where they are, and that's a way that we can keep you here and also go to your sense of mission and provide a service for our community.
Thank you very much. Any other rebuttals? And let's move on to the next round, which is the lightning round. And what we'll do is we'll start from Mr. Fox and come down to Mr. Freeman. And we'll just continue going back and forth like that. So the first question is, name 3 to 5 charities that you donate to.
Okay. My wife, Carrington, is on the board of Casa Azafran. Is one we do the Jewish Federation of Nashville, and we Boy Scouts.
Thank you.
I'd go with my church, with Best Buddies, and Casa Azafran.
Thank you. Ms. Berry?
The Bell Court, the YWCA, which I serve on the board, and the ACLU.
Thank you very much. Ms. Eskin-Rebrovic?
Yes, we recently donated to Legal Aid Services, Girl Scouts of America, and Jewish Federation.
Mr. King?
Sister Cities, our church, Legal Aid, and Casa.
Thank you. Mr. Gentry?
Boy Scouts, Pinion Ridge, and the Frist Center.
Thank you. Mr. Freeman?
Casa Azafran, the Sexual Abuse Center, Belmont, and the YWCA and the YMCA.
Thank you very much. Next one is a yes or no question. We'll start with Mr. Freeman and go to Mr. Fox. Should the Metro Nashville Planning Commission adopt the Nashville Next Plan this Monday? Mr. Freeman.
That's a yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Oh, goodness. I would say yes.
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 Yes, I guess, yes. The next question, we'll start with Mr. Fox and go back. If you were not running for mayor, whom would you want to see elected mayor of these candidates?
That's a fair question. I think the front and center issue for our city is education, and I think there are two of us who've had deep history in understanding the challenge. Mr. Kane has had experience in the charter school side. That's where I would
like. Thank you. Mr. Bone?
They're all fine people, all of whom I have respect for, but if there were somebody up here that I could vote for, I wouldn't be running.
Ms. Berry?
Whoa. So David, you and I had a nice conversation earlier about doing a write-in campaign for you. So there we go.
All right, I'm not running. Ms. Eskin-Rubberbeck.
Yeah, I'm going to answer that question by saying I'm part of the 31% who is still undecided.
Mr. Kane.
Let me give a non-political answer, and Howard Gentry.
Mr. Gentry.
Non-political answer, David Fox.
And Mr. Freeman.
Yeah, you know, I've thought about this a lot, and I think what I'd like to tell you is that we have a great field of candidates. Everybody on this stage has their own unique qualities, and everyone on this stage would make a great mayor. I've answered this question before, and I'll stick with my answer, Linda Reperbeck.
Thank you very much. And that ends our round two. Because of time, we're moving on to round three. Thank you very much again. So this next question will be asked by Caitlin Midget.
Hi, I'm Caitlin Midget, and I'm an entertainment industry studies major at Belmont University, and I'm a rising senior. My question is, if elected, what would be the first change that you would make and why?
This question goes to Mr. Freeman, Mr. Fox, and Mr. Kane. Mr. Freeman.
The first thing that I would do is start working on a mass transit solution for our community. And I wouldn't work on an AMP-type project. There were a lot of good minds and good people that worked on the AMP. But I think what we need is a regional mass transit solution that takes care of the traffic between all the bedroom communities, between Murfreesboro, between Franklin, between Lebanon and Nashville, all the bedroom communities. And I would start on day one working on a regional mass transit solution. I like to say we're probably 10 years late in starting to work on it. It's probably a 10-year plan if we start in the morning. It's not a $167 million solution or problem. It's a $3 or $4 or $5 or $6 billion problem, but we need to start working on it, and I'll do that day one.
Thank you very much, Mr. Freeman. Mr. Fox.
Yes, Caitlin, this is one of the most critical times in our history that I can recall. We're getting a new mayor, a majority of new Metro Council members, and a new superintendent all within a few week period. The first thing I would do is reach out to the school board. That, in my view, is the most critical thing going on outside of this election right here. I want to develop a good relationship with the school board members. I found in working with Mayor Dean that the role of the mayor is so critical in helping pull the school board together. And when I was on the school board, it's not always an easy group to make cohesive. You won't have unanimity, but you can have consensus. And that is so important if we want to have better schools here in Nashville. That would be my job one, developing a good relationship with our school board.
Thank you very much, Mr. Fox. Mr. Kane.
Day one, and I've said it every single debate, and we'll say it again tonight, is we would hold a cabinet meeting. And sitting around our table would be the head of MDHA, who does not work for me as mayor. It would be the new school superintendent, who does not work for me as mayor, and the head of the MTA, who does not work for me as mayor. But we have to set the tone and the expectation that going forward, that when we talk about education, we're not just going to talk about what happens inside our schools. It is about transit. It is about affordable housing. It is about economic development. When we talk about transit, those are linked to affordable housing. So day one, that cabinet meeting would set the tone that we are all in this together. We are all part of metro government, and it's not just one department or one area in one issue. Because if we're going to tackle education and transit and housing, we need the resources and the benefits of all of metro government attacking it all together.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kane. Any rebuttals? Thank you very much. We'll move on to the next question. Batya Carabel.
I'm Batya Carabel. I grew up in Nashville and work in higher education compliance. I'm representing the Jewish Federation of Nashville and Middle Tennessee, where I'm active in its NowGen Young Jewish Professionals group. Today, I'm heartbroken at the relevance of my question in light of the tragic event of 9 people being murdered at Emmanuel AME Church in Charleston. As you may be aware, in our own community, swastikas were painted on a Jewish fraternity house in March, and a shot was fired at West End Synagogue in April. As mayor, what will you do to ensure the safety and security of the Jewish community, along with all other faiths in Nashville?
This question is for Mr. Bone, Mr. Gentry, and Ms. Eskind-Rubberbeck. Mr. Bone.
Your question is very timely. Certainly when I saw the news late last night and woke up to get the update in the middle of the night, my first thought, beyond what a tragic event and how heartbroken we all were, was to think about how do I explain this to my children. But my second thought was, well, what if I was African American? How would I explain that to my children, given all the recent events that we've seen? Could I tell them that they're safe at a playground, at a swimming pool, at a park, and now I got to explain whether or not they're safe at church? We've seen the same thing happen here. We've also seen it at our mosque in 2010 and 2013. Nashville is better than that. We have to stand up as a city and say, not only is it where you were born, but your faith, you will be treated with dignity and respect in all of Nashville.
Thank you very much. Mr. Gentry.
I'm glad you asked that question. It's unfortunate that we have to. We've been in forums for, I don't know, almost 40 forums, and the question just doesn't get asked. And the problem is that violent crime is really tearing cities apart. It's threatening to tear our city apart. Every day we're hearing about murders, shootings, rapes at a all-time high. It's just a problem. And what we have to do is get out of that, out in front of that problem. It's not a police matter. It's a people matter. What I would do as mayor is bring communities together. And we're going to go out and really deal with this on the front end. We've got to sensitize our communities again, work with our young people, work with families, and bring peace back into our community. I'll lead that effort as your mayor, and I've already started. I've already started as your criminal court clerk. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gentry. Ms. Eskin-Rebovic.
Yes, it's an unbelievably tragic situation, and I also have lived through being scared my whole life because of the situations you describe. It is unfortunate that we still have an environment in America where this is not a one-off situation, where there is some white supremacy, where there is such terrible discrimination. We in Nashville are better than that. We won't accept that happening in our city. We will make sure that we do everything to bring this community together, to make sure that people understand that our metro government is one that has no tolerance for this kind of behavior, that our city has no tolerance for this kind of behavior. And we will build a team by bringing everybody to the table. That's how I have always led, by making sure that every voice is heard, make sure people from both sides of the equation have a chance to talk and work it out. That's how you solve problems. It's not by driving people apart.
Thank you, Ms. Eskin-Rebovic. Are there any rebuttals? Mr. Freeman.
No, what a horrible, horrible tragedy. But what I think this question is about, it's not necessarily about racial profiling, and certainly there was probably some of that involved, but it was about mentally ill. And how does a mentally ill person purchase a handgun and own a weapon like that? We need to take a look at the laws that are in place on the national level that will keep a mentally ill person from owning a weapon.
Thank you very much, Mr. Any other rebuttals? Mr. Fox.
In our history, Nashville has had our own hate crimes. I've explained to my boys who are here, Oscar, Julius, and Simon, a few months ago, we read a story about what happened to Hattie Cotton. You know, a few years after that, the Jewish Community Center I attended was firebombed. And so, you know, our history has been upset with this, but we've had good leadership from the mayor's office, from all of our city. I mean, we're a great place. What makes Nashville special, we really do care about one another. It's an unusually civil city. And I hope as mayor to be
much,
a good
Mr.
example
Fox.
On that.
Thank you. Mr. Gentry.
I just can't sit back and let this be mental illness. It's taking our heads out of the sand and understanding that we have a problem. And it's a societal problem that we've got to fix. It's our responsibility. Everybody pulling the trigger, everybody doing these things are not crazy. They don't have mental illness. They're misdirected, and we have got to change that direction. And as your mayor, again, I'm going to lead an effort to do that, and we as a community will do it together. Thank you.
Any other rebuttals? But we'll move on to the next question. This will be asked by Diana Montero.
Hello, my name is Diana Montero. I am a dreamer and a member of the Tennessee Immigrant and Refugee Rights Coalition. There are an estimated 33,000 undocumented immigrants living in Nashville. However, many metro agencies and staff do not have the information and resources they need to address the unique challenges and experiences of undocumented residents. For example, my guidance counselor didn't have the tools to support me when I wanted to go to college. And many in the criminal justice system don't understand that a minor infraction with law enforcement could lead to my mom's deportation. My question is, how will your office equip all Metro employees to better understand experiences like mine and ensure that all residents have access to critical services and programs?
This question is for Mr. Kane, Ms. Eskin-Rebrovic, and Mr. Bone. Mr. Kane.
I think there's a lot in this question, so let me try to be brief in a minute. First thing is we need to follow the lead of Lipscomb University, is what they looked at with their undergrads. If they wanted to get a teaching degree, you had to be English language learner certified, is what they saw as the majority of their teachers were coming to work here in Nashville. And as we look at the diversity and the changing demographics of Nashville, it was a smart move. I think that's a great move where we can, again, have that conversation, have that cultural relevance, and make those connections. I proposed what's called a Music City card. It's in place in Chicago and also Oakland. This is a card, it's an identification card that you can use as a bus pass or a library card or an identification for all residents. And so it's a way of leveling that playing field and making everyone feel welcome here in Nashville. I think the other piece is Casa Asafran is a great example if we look at it with the crosswalk in multiple languages. That is a welcoming sign to all of our residents, and that's what we continue to do in Nashville.
Thank you. Ms. Eskin-Rebrovic.
Yes, I applaud Mayor Dean and his administration for putting together the Office of New Americans. And I think that office has done a phenomenal job, and I will continue to support it and enhance it and make sure that we continue to provide the programs that are necessary to help you integrate into the community, to help you get citizenship. I give credit to Mr. Kane. I was going to talk about this too. The municipal ID card that Oakland uses, I think, is a very innovative idea. It can be used for IDs to make sure that you can get in, you know, a bank account, that makes sure you can get buy a home, to make sure you can use any facility that requires an ID. There's also opportunities to use it as a check cashing card, you know, where you've got a debit card. So I would also like to see us look at that kind of innovative idea and marry that together with the New Americans Office so that we can support you and make sure that you have the services that you need. Thank you.
Thank you. Mr. Bone.
I think we have several opportunities going forward. One example of that is what's happening in our school system. We hire approximately 850 new teachers every year. Despite the fact that our student population is about 20% Latino, only 1% of our teachers are Latino. That's a tremendous opportunity for us going forward, both working with our local colleges and universities, but also as we retool. I think the second thing is you need a mayor who's going to stand up and say, we have a strategy for full integration. To provide working with the mayor's office of New Americans to ensure that we have a strategy that says all those who are either undocumented, foreign-born, or first-generation Americans will have an equal opportunity to access all parts of government, all services, and all programs, but also the right to fully participate civically in professional life, in civic life, and in politics. I think we have to say that as a city, and you need a mayor who's going to say that and set that tone and set that strategy for the city, and that's what I will do as mayor.
Thank you, Mr. Boone. Any rebuttals? Mr. Gentry?
No, we also need a mayor that's already put these kind of programs in place. This is not really about crime, but I'm the criminal court clerk, and we do a program called Bringing Justice to You, where we don't just sit back, but we partner with the school system and bring information out to the community. And so if we're in a community where a different language is spoken, we bring people with us who can communicate. And just with expungements, 4 years ago, we were averaging 8,000 expungements a year. We're up to around 30,000 expungements a year, and that's because we're educating people all over the city.
And that was your final rebuttal for this round. Any other rebuttals? Ms. Berry.
We sent a really great message several years ago when we said English only was not what we wanted to be as a city. Now we actually have to say, how does our government work best for people whose language skills maybe not up to par and be able to interface with what the services that they need. And you brought up a great point. And I got to tell you, one of the things that I will do as mayor is to make sure that we actually have folks who speak languages in metro government.
Thank you very much, Ms. Berry. Any other rebuttals? Move on to the next question, McLean Pillen.
Hello, my name is McLean Pillen. I'm a native Nashvillian and currently a junior here at Belmont University studying political science. My question, in regards to transit, the term multimodal is often referenced. What specifically would you like to see added to the Nashville area in terms of transportation options?
Thank this you. Question is for Ms. Berry, Mr. Freeman, and Mr. Gentry. Ms. Berry?
So when we talk about multimodal, it really is about not just cars, it's about buses, it's about trains, it's about light rail, it's about bikes, it's about greenways, it's about sidewalks. It's about anything that you are going to get on. Our biggest challenge is getting you out of your car and onto some other kind of transit. And as your next mayor, I've talked about this. We need to bring all modalities under one roof in the mayor's office, and that's what I'm going to do. I want to make sure that we are expending our resources so that we can actually, when we look at a complete street, if you go down right now at the Gulch this weekend, we're having a huge celebration because now we're going to have a sidewalk, a bike lane, a bus lane, all of these pieces. And that's going to make you much more likely to get out of your car. But ultimately, getting you out of your car and onto something else, you've got to have usually a sidewalk to do it. And so in my administration, we're going to spend the money we need to make sure that the sidewalks are connecting to those transit lines so that you can get to where you need to go. And that's what multimodal is.
Thank you very much, Ms. Berry. Mr. Freeman.
Thank you. You know, we have multimodal transit systems right now. But what we don't have is a workable mass transit piece of that that worked with all these other systems that, we have in place right now. I told you a few moments ago that we're 10 years behind getting started. We're 10 years away if we start today. We've got to start on a regional mass transit system on day one, and that's the answer to our traffic problems. That's the answer to our mass transit problems, and we've got to start on that day one. And I've told you that's a big priority for me. I've talked about it for over a year, and I'll go to work on that day one.
Thank you very much. Mr. Gentry.
What I would like to see is a system that moves people around their communities, their neighborhoods. And we have a bus line that actually could work. We have a public transportation system that could work. We have circulator buses that work in the city, but they're not in the areas that people live out of the outlying areas in the outer core. And what we need to do is have a system that does take people from their homes to their jobs, to the store, to the school, back home again. And if they want to connect and come downtown, that is an option. I rode the Blue Line a couple days ago, and it took me down to the Gulch. I got me a smoothie and came back. Three people on the bus. The fact is, we have got to educate people and then provide the transportation needed and have people utilizing our services that could be beneficial to them.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gentry. Are there any rebuttals? Mr. Fox?
A few hours ago, I was attending a transit conference downtown, and one of the speakers said he had just seen a very cool billboard along the roadside. It said, "You are not stuck in traffic. You are the traffic." And the takeaway from that is kind of we are the problem, and we can be the solution. So my idea is let's crowdsource this. Let's not rely on one person to take my idea. Let's find out what the community has an appetite for. And if it's bus, if it's light rail, we can get there. Thanks.
Thank you, Mr. Fox. And that was your last rebuttal of the round. Ms. Eskin-Rebervik.
Good news is that our community has been working on this for a while now, and I also agree that this is a huge priority. We have to keep it moving forward. Our traffic is becoming a terrible situation for us, so I have already started on it. I've created a policy paper that talks about what multimodal means, and the good news is that we're going to have the right transportation for each different community. This policy paper talks about the fact that we are also going to have a plan in your hand within 120 days after I'm elected your mayor so that we can keep moving forward.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bowen.
So I think at the top of that list would be sidewalks, and to be honest with you, that's probably not where I started in this campaign. But two things have changed. One, as I've tried to ride the bus from my house to downtown, what I learned that riding the bus was easy. It takes me 30 minutes on the ride. The hard part is getting there. I'm 9/10 of a mile from that bus stop. I have to go through four streets, one quiet neighborhood street, two busy cut-through streets, and a four-lane highway, and there's not a sidewalk on one of them. It takes me longer to get to the bus and wait on the bus than the actual ride. That's the easy part. The second thing...
Thank you very much, Mr. Bowen. Mr. Kane.
Whatever the mode of transportation, whatever it comes back to, it always ends up with our roads. 8 years ago, 78% of our roads were deemed acceptable. Today, 61% of our roads are deemed acceptable. That shows our commitment to getting us around this city. After 4 years as your mayor, no one will ever question my commitment to get you to and where you're going.
Thank you, Mr. Kane. Any other rebuttals? We'll move on to the next question. Dulce Quintero.
Hello. I'm Dulce Quintero, the Director of Youth Services at the YWCA of Nashville, Middle Tennessee, which I'm representing, and I oversee all the program operations for Girls Inc. In my role as Youth Services Director, I see firsthand how sexual harassment in schools and teen dating violence is a common occurrence. Nationally, 1 in 10 girls is physically hurt by a partner, 1 in 5 is sexually assaulted, and 1 in 3 experience abuse in a romantic relationship. Would you support and encourage the school system to implement a dating violence and anti-harassment policy? And if so, what would it look like?
This question is from Ms. Eskin Rebrovic, Mr. Bone, and Mr. Fox.
Yes, growing up a woman, being the mother of a daughter, I understand the importance of this question and how we cannot allow this to continue. I would absolutely support an anti-violence program in our schools, and I want to make sure that it is integrated into the behavior and every decision that gets made in those schools, and that I am also excited about the program called Men that YWCA has put together, because it's real important for our young men and our boys to understand that this could be their mother, this could be their daughter, this could be their sister. When they go into this kind of a situation, they have to step back and think about their behavior. We have to train them to make sure that this doesn't continue to happen. You know, there's just nothing worse than feeling like you are going to be overpowered by somebody else. And those are the kind of programs that I would bring to the school system to make sure that that stops.
Thank you very much. Mr. Bone?
This is personal to me. I've got 3 daughters, ages 13, 12, and 8. I want them to grow up in a city, in an environment where they're not only safe, but they're also valued and respected, where they have the same education and employment opportunities as my son does. I want them to grow up in an environment where they can think and live independently and where they can be healthy. Interestingly enough, I want the same opportunities for my son, the same as I want for my daughters. But what I know is that my son needs to be a part of helping bring about those opportunities for them. I do think this starts with men. I think it starts with men setting the tone and saying these are not acceptable. So without question, I would be in favor of that, both in the school system, implementing that, and setting the tone throughout Nashville.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bowen. Mr. Fox.
I think when people will look back on Mayor Dean's legacy, a lot of people will be tempted to talk about a bunch of buildings, a lot of buildings, exciting buildings downtown. When I look back on it, I look specifically at the domestic violence initiative. He took initiative. He assembled the people, recognized it was a problem. It had always been a problem. But until the mayor stepped up and used the power of convening, not a lot happened. And so it took a lot of coordination. I thought that was a beautiful demonstration of what a mayor can accomplish for humans, not just buildings, but for human beings. I take your point. I think that's a very important issue, and I would certainly want to bring to bear the same sort of process that Mayor Dean has brought together for the same issue you're talking about.
Thank you very much, Mr. Fox. Are there any rebuttals? We'll move on to the next question then, and this will be given by Maria Zapata.
Hello, my name is Maria Zapata, and I'm the Family Engagement Manager at Conexión Américas. I realize some of you may have been inside our beautiful building, Casa Azafrán. So as part of my role, I coordinate a program for Latino parents. So I have a lot of exposure into immigrant families, many of whom may not attend traditional candidate-oriented events or cannot use voting power to hold candidates accountable. Given that they are still valuable and contributing members of the Nashville community and economy, how will you seek out their voices and ensure that their varied needs are being met?
This question is for Mr. Gentry, Ms. Berry, and Mr. Freeman. Mr. Gentry.
Whether you're an immigrant, whether you were born in the United States, you're a human being, and you are a citizen of this community. And everyone deserves to be treated with respect. So as your mayor, I would demand that. I'm a person that, in my past, I was not treated very respectful. And I know how it feels. I also know how it can keep you in the back and not make you feel like you are a part or as good. But we as a community are going to have to open our arms and reach out and just understand that the differences don't mean that it's a bad thing. Instead, it's a good thing. We will be the kind of city that is welcoming. We'll be a city that serves everyone, no matter their background, no matter their circumstances. And if I lead in that manner, the culture of this city will follow, and those problems won't be problems
anymore.
Thank
you very much, Mr. Gentry. Ms. Berry.
Someone's status should never, ever determine their ability to engage in our community. I shouldn't get in a car in the morning to take my child to school and be terrified that I'm going to be pulled over and taken away and separated from my child because of my status. And I really firmly believe that our government needs to make sure that we are protectors of individuals who are here, regardless of what their status is. And in my administration, what I will do is I will make sure that where we are putting our energy and our resources is to continue to be a warm and welcoming place. And that means providing language skills so that we can interface with government, so that you can make sure that you are not afraid when you are in that car, and that our police are not putting their resources into pulling you over and creating fear.
Thank you, Ms. Berry. Mr. Freeman.
I had a meeting a few months ago with a prominent member of our community, and he told me that he had met with all of the candidates, and all great candidates, as I've said earlier, and he said all of them told him what they were going to do. I met with him for about an hour, and he said, "You're the only candidate that has told me what you've already done." And in terms of Casa Asafran, Babsy and I are longtime major supporters. I think we're one of the largest individual financial supporters of Casa Asafran and all the causes and things that go on in that community. We're strong supporters of. We have been. We will be. I will be in the mayor's office, and I'll continue to focus on those issues.
Thank you very much, Mr. Freeman. Are there any rebuttals? Very well. Our final question from a millennial tonight is from Hayden Rutledge.
I'm Hayden Rutledge, a junior international politics major at Belmont University, and I hope to continue my education by attending law school after I graduate. I would like you to essentially sell me Nashville under your administration. Like many people in this city, I'm about to be a recent college graduate, and I have to decide whether I want to stay in Nashville or move somewhere else. Under your administration, what reason would a 20-something recent college graduate have for staying in Nashville?
And this question is for Mr. Fox, Mr. Kane, and Ms. Berry. Mr. Fox.
Great, great question, Hayden. You know, Nashville has evolved in being a great free-flowing community. I've had friends who go to New York and you work 18-hour days, not a real balanced lifestyle, the same thing in other occupations. But people who come here into Nashville and stay here, you have a balanced lifestyle. Yeah, we work hard. You start a business or start out on your own, it's a full day. But at the end of the day, you take off and hear some music and you relax. And I think our balance of quality of life here is something we have to protect. Yeah, I'm focused. I think we're at a critical point. The growth we've had has been awesome. This city is so much more culturally interesting and prosperous than it ever has been because people have thrown in a lot with us to live here. But we're at a point now where if we're not careful, if we don't shore up our infrastructure, watch how much money we're spending, which are related issues, especially work on transit, we're going to have to, we might lose our quality of life. So I promise to do all I can to maintain our quality of life so it'll be a great spot for you for your career. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kane.
My family moved here almost 30 years ago, and Mayor Fulton was the mayor at that time, and he saved the Ryman and at the same time built the old convention center. He put in $416 million worth of sewers throughout our community that allowed us to grow, but also put the bricks on Church Street. really preserved our character while we continue to grow. 30 years later, here we are, and I think we're at a transition moment in our history, is as we look forward, what 30 years from now is going to drive our growth? And so how I would sell you is stay in Nashville and be part of this exhilarating process of defining who we are over the next 30 years. I believe that education can be the most optimistic, collaborative, and successful thing we do. You can go to law school, but I want to persuade you to get involved in education because you have a voice that matters. Transportation and transit and fixing our traffic concerns can be transformative as a community. It means more people want to come here, more people want to stay here, and they can get around. That's why you need to be in Nashville, because 30 years from now, you can say, I set the tone of where we went.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kane. Ms. Berry.
Nashville is made up of millennials and boomerangs. And what we want is we want to keep you both. So how do we do that? I need to sell you on Nashville. You need to stay here because this is an exciting place. I came here like you to go to school, and I ended up staying. And I stayed because I love this town. We have so much potential, and the potential we can realize with the millennials. I'm so excited that you guys are coming along because we need a lot of help. We need help on transit. We need help on affordable housing, and we need help on education. And so we've left some of these in not so great a shape. So what we do know, though, is that millennials care deeply about transit. In fact, you choose where you're going to live based on your transit options. So we have to get our transit right. But we also have to make sure that it's an affordable place to live and you have things to do. Right now we're excelling at things to do. Now we just need to figure out the rest. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Berry. And for rebuttals, those who have a rebuttal left are Ms. Berry, Mr. Bone, Mr. Freeman, Mr. Kane, and Ms. Eskind-Rebervik. Do any of you want to use one of your rebuttals? Ms. Eskind-Rebervik.
Last question.
This is the last question, and I'll be going to a final, but you have a rebuttal. This is the last millennial question. I do have a couple of extra questions because we do have time. But would any of you like to rebut or add any additional in 30 seconds?
Sure. Okay.
Perfect. Ms. Eskind-Rebervik.
Every city in this country wants to be Nashville. They would love to have the growth that we have in this city right now. The increase in the number of jobs, the opportunities for you are unbelievable, and everyone would love to be this city, number one. Number two, the quality of life is unparalleled. We have music, we have arts, and we have culture, and those are a thriving industry for our city. We have tourism that gives us a vibrant community with restaurants and sports and other exciting
things
that you can do.
Mr. Freeman.
I just read a stat the other day that amazed me, but it said that Nashville was the number two destination city for 25-year-old and younger college grads in the country. We have 85 a day, 25-year-old and younger college grads moving to Nashville. That's 30,000 a year or so. When I started in business, the total population growth for Nashville was 25,000 people a year. Nashville is red hot. It's a city of great opportunity. We have a tremendous number of talented young people moving
Thank
in.
Thank you very much, Mr. Freeman.
Thank you.
Mr. Bowen.
Nashville is a great city with an authenticity that most cities would die for. However, our status as a great city today is not guaranteed tomorrow. We have big challenges, a lot of challenges which we've discussed tonight, but I believe that the solutions to those challenges are certainly within our reach. I would ask you not only to just get involved the next 49 days, but be a part of Nashville's future in addressing those challenges and ensuring we remain a great city.
Thank you. Mr. Kane, Ms. Berry, would you like to use your time? Okay. I'm going to ask a quick lightning round question, and we'll go to a final statement. And we'll start with Mr. Freeman and go to Mr. Fox. Being that it was CMA Music Festival last week, what country music song do you think best represents your experience in Nashville?
Holy smoke. Country music song, let me think here. Goodness gracious. Something from Johnny Cash, maybe. I can't think.
All right.
I'm sorry. Thank you. You got it.
Mr. Gentry. Mr. Gentry.
Oh, I thought you were going to Miss Fox. I'm sorry. Give me your question again.
What country music song do you think best represents your experience in Nashville?
Oh. Wow. Wild, Wild West.
All right, Mr. Kane.
This is not reflective at all of my experience in Nashville. It's the only song stuck in my head, and I'm going to embarrass myself as Achy Breaky Heart.
Ms. Eskin-Rubrick.
Yes, I have to go with Ben Skill's song, What You Give Away, because this is a city where it's so important to give back, and that song really describes that.
Thank you. Ms. Berry.
Emmylou Harris's Red Dirt Girl.
Mr. Bone.
I'm going with the new Keith Urban song, John Cougar, John Deere, John 316.
Thank you very much. Mr. Fox.
I'm going to slightly skip genres and go to What Did the Fox Say?
Very good. So before I ask the final question, a quick announcement. The poll has been activated on Tennessean.com. You can choose who you thought won this debate tonight. It'll be open through noon on Friday. Again, that's Tennessean.com. The poll is open. And the final question for all of you, and again, just a 30-second response, please, is why are you the best mayor for the millennial generation here in Nashville? And let's start with Mr. Fox, and then we'll end with Mr. Freeman.
I was raised not to say I'm the best, but I've been asked, so I'll give you a response. I've been here all my life. I love the city. I've tried to give back where I can. Kind of an old Boy Scout trying to leave the campfire better than you found it. I've tried to leave our city better than I found it. Had opportunities to build some businesses. I understand how to create jobs, create wealth. I've also had an opportunity to help our school board become a functional organization. That's 40% of our entire budget. Came in at a time when the state was about to take it over. I'd like to bring those skills to bear on your behalf as well. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bowen.
I think we have to understand going forward that our 353 kindergarten teachers are just as important to the success of Nashville as the 16 cranes between this auditorium and downtown. That repairing our water and sewer lines, many of which are more than 40 years old, is just as important as the success of the two-year-old Music City Center. That the stability of our neighborhoods is just as important as the vibrancy of downtown, and that the 40% of our single moms living in poverty are just as important to the future of Nashville as our bankers, our entrepreneurs, and our CEOs.
Thank you very much, Mr. Bowen. Ms. Berry.
I believe that our city has to continue to move, and a city that's moving is a city that's thriving. We have to continue to grow. We also have to make sure that we stay affordable, not just in Davidson County, but in throughout our entire region. We also need to make sure that we are focused on education. Public education is the most important thing our city does. And if we don't get that right, then we are doing our children an incredible disservice. And why you as millennials should look to us, and to me specifically, is because I will bring you along with me. This is a journey I can't do alone, and I need you, and I need your help to make Nashville an amazing place that we all know it can be.
Thank you, Ms. Berry. Ms. Eskin-Rubrick.
I'm the mayor that you should choose to lead this city as a millennial because I have a vision of building a smarter Nashville. And what this means is that we are going to bring business, discipline, and innovation to make sure your government works more efficiently and effectively. It's not just about technology. It's about combining technology with bold new ideas to make sure that Nashville is livable for all of our families, all of our millennials, everyone of every age group, to give you your time back, to make sure that you can have confidence that we are going to run this government in a way that's fiscally responsible and that we will have smart growth.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kane.
I believe that we need to have a mayor who has the energy to match yours, the innovation and creativity to match many of yours, the humility to ask for help, the wisdom to know that there are people out there who are smarter than me. I believe that I bring that unique set. I bring a record of results and a record of collaboration. That's why you should vote for me on August 6th. My name is Jeremy Kane. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Gentry.
I might not know the country song that I wanted to say, but I definitely know that I have the experience to lead the city. And I've had the experience of being your vice mayor, your councilman at large, your criminal court clerk. I've had experience in business, in education. And Nashville needs experience now. They need a mayor that can wrap his arms around everything that Nashville needs and not just deal with today's problems, but to deal with tomorrow and the next and the next. I want to make Nashville the place not just for you to enjoy today, but but also to raise your family. I don't want to just make Nashville better. I want to make you better. If you're better, this whole city's better. Our crime goes down. Our education is improved. Our children are better. The health of this city is better. And it is truly the it city for everyone. And I want to help make Nashville the it city for everyone. And the experience that I have will lead us in that direction. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Gentry. Mr. Freeman.
I've spent my career working on affordable housing. I know what we need to do. I mentioned this to you earlier, but I know what we need to do to develop the affordable housing and a significant number of them over the next 4 years. I also am the only candidate up here that didn't think the AMP was the best solution for the city and that has talked about from day one a regional mass transit system. That's a very important piece of whoever the next mayor is. We have to start working on that, and I think I'm the man to do that. I also have embraced the creative industry in Nashville. The 41,000 songwriters and singers and potters and artists that make our city Music City USA. We do less per capita than any of our peer cities around the country. We need to embrace that part of our community and help them. My name is Bill Freeman. I'd love to be your next mayor. Please give me some consideration. Thank you.
Thank you. And before we conclude, I'd like to recognize our millennials, Kirk Beto, Belmont University, Suad Abdullah, Islamic Center of Nashville, Christoph Hart, Belmont University, Benjamin Eagles, the Nashville Organized for Action and Hope, Jonathan Joyce, Belmont University, Ariel Ellis, National Coalition of 100 Black Women, Metro Nashville Chapter, Danny Costurco, Belmont University, Caitlin Midget, Belmont University, Batia Carabel, Jewish Federation of Nashville and Middle Tennessee, Diana Montero, Tennessee Immigrants and Refugee Rights Coalition, Dulce Quintero, YWCA, McLean Pillen, Belmont University, Maria Paula Zapata, Conexión Americas, Hayden Rutledge, Belmont University. Please rise and give them a round of applause, please. And with that, remember the election is August 6th. The deadline to register to vote is July 7th. Let's thank our candidates for a wonderful debate.